Welcome, Facebook friends. Here we are once again. We have another interview for Meet the Messenger TV. And our in-studio guest right now is Miss Marti Martin. And we're going to talk about her ministry, about her speaking, about the lives that she has challenged, and the ways that God has challenged her life. And as we share some of those ideas, you're probably going to hear some things you've never heard before, and some very direct talk. So be prepared to kind of be shaken a little bit. But I think you're going to have a really good time as well. And if you run a church or a ministry and you are responsible for booking speakers, you want to get your pen and your pencil out so that you can have contact information later, because I promise you, you're going to want it. I'm just telling you. That's your fair warning, and that's all the warning you get. And that's as fair as it gets. Glad that came before we started the regular cameras. Glad that you're behind the scenes with us. I'm glad that you're having a good time with us. I hope you'll stay through the whole program and share it thousands of times with lots and lots of people. I think so far our best is about 200 views live. We have had some audience guests or some studio guests that had somewhere around 600 views while the video was live. So let's see if we can break 1,000. So share this with everybody you know. We would love to have everybody knowing what Marti's doing in the kingdom and what Jesus has called her to do. So share it with everybody. And thanks again to our sponsor, Insperity. Our local representative is Frank Day, 214-699-9650. Frank Day is available to help with any needs that you might have, from benefits to human resources to in-house accounting. Anything that you need like that, Insperity is capable of it, and they can serve you just about anywhere in the globe. And Zach, you just moved that camera. You got to be more delicate with that. It moved. You're still okay in frame, but don't push the camera around. All right. And y'all be quiet behind the scenes over there, because we're just... All right, ready for the real cameras. All rolling, audio. Is the audio recording? All right. Welcome to Meet the Messenger. I am your host, J. Lauren Norris, and our in-studio guest today is Miss Marti Martin. We're going to talk about what God has called her to do in a very challenging field of ministry, in a place where a lot of people wouldn't want to go at all, much less as a mom, as a wife. As a female, she walks into probably some of the darkest places you could ever imagine walking, but she does it in grace and love with the courage of a lion, because it's her calling, and it's also her story. So thank you, Marti, for spending time with us today.
It's very nice to be here. Thank you.
Very honored that you're here. Yeah. Now, when you and I first met, it was through SWIMA, I believe, mm-hmm. the Christian Women and Media Association. Right. And so I knew you as a speaker, and we kind of briefly heard about things that you'd done, but more as an administrative role. I didn't know much about what your calling is. And so the first time I heard, well, she speaks in prisons, I thought, well, that's nice. You know, people in prison need to be challenged with their spiritual condition and you know, get to know Christ. And then I heard she speaks in men's prisons, and I went, well, that's just weird. Why would a beautiful woman want to go into the men's prisons? And then I heard what you talk about, and I went, okay, that's just nuts. I can't imagine how your husband feels when he knows that you're going off to do what God's called you to do.
He's smart enough to not get in the way.
And so I think of the warriors of Scripture, and over and over and over again, even they had to be reminded, be bold, be strong, because I'm with you. And yet, we sometimes embark on a journey in life and go, have I lost my mind? Why am I doing this? What led you to serve in the type of ministry that you serve in? And I'm going to let you describe what that looks like, because I don't want to say it in the wrong way.
No, that's fine. You know, what led me to that is the fact that I had worked with victims for so many years, victims of sexual assault. And having worked with victims, you know, you can work with a victim, you can express everything that they need to do, and you can meet with them, and you can ask them questions, and you can help process them through healing. But at the end of the day, you need to really accept that you can be healed. And I just realized that it was such an incredibly difficult turnaround for someone who had been victimized in this way. The victims stay victims for a very long time. And it affects literally every area of a woman's life when she's been sexually assaulted. And so I realized that they were a very difficult turnaround. I myself am a sexual abuse survivor. So I know that it was a very difficult turnaround for me. to really say that you can overcome being sexually assaulted is not an easy thing. You have to be willing to forgive. You have to be willing to let go. You have to be willing to open up your heart again.
Wow.
And it's a very difficult thing for someone who's been through something like that. So I had processed myself through that, and so I decided I wanted to work with victims and help them. So I did so, and I did for a while, only to realize that it was a very hard thing to turn around. And so I just had the bright idea while in the shower one day. It's like, you know, it would be really great if I could get a hold of the perpetrators. Because if I can change a perpetrator, then I have no more victims. And so I started to try and figure out, how can I get them all gathered in one place so that I can talk to him about all this?
And you realize somebody's already done that.
And I realized the prison has them.
Okay,
wow.
So let me ask you this question, because if they're already in prison
mm-hmm.
for being a perpetrator,
mm-hmm.
isn't this already a lost cause?
No, not necessarily, because when they get out, and see, here's the thing, is that everybody thinks they're not getting out. Well, I got a news flash. They get out, and they're coming to a neighborhood near you.
Wow.
I mean, if you check out the red dots, you'll see that you have sex offenders all over the place.
So unless you live in an elementary
and
school,
you're
going to have them in your neighborhood.
You can have them in your neighborhood. And so the thing about it is that many of them are not rehabilitated. Prison is punitive in nature. It's not rehabilitation. And so there's...
That's a huge statement. Say that again.
You'll have to say that. What did I say? It was really good.
Prison is... Yeah. Prison is punitive in nature, not rehabilitative
in
nature.
That's right. That's absolutely
and
true.
And I think that there are a lot of people from a religious standpoint who see Christianity that way. They see the legalism side of don't.
Absolutely.
And they don't see the transformation side of grace.
They don't see that it's for freedom's sake, that you are set free when you come to Christ. And so, and that's the very same thing that these guys are caught in. They're caught in a trap. And so God gave me this idea, and I thought, you know, I want to do a workshop because I think they need to hear it from my perspective. And so I went down to Huntsville, and I pitched my idea, and I thought I was just going to be meeting with, you know, just like a volunteer coordinator or something. Anyway, I met with like four or five people that are the therapist and the people that oversee all of the sex offenders for the state of Texas.
Wow.
I didn't really understand who I was meeting with, and I kind of walk in with just, you know, just me and my book and my idea, and ended up in this boardroom with these guys where I had to do a all-out pitch for the program. And they said, let's give it a try. And
wow.
I said, okay. But the first thing I said to them all as we sat around the table that day was, I'm not angry. This is not going to be a victim panel. This is not me coming
wow.
from that perspective. And so I pitched my idea. They loved it. They said, let's do a pilot of the program. And we started it, and we've just taken off from there.
What kind of results do you see from the people? And when we come back from the break, I want to poke at this a little differently, because I think there are a lot of people who, like you said, they come at it from an angry standpoint. And so they almost operate in an I want revenge way of saying, I'm going to rehabilitate you. I'm going to change you. You're going to feel sorry for what you did. You're going to be condemned for what you did. I can't see that as a rehabilitative process either, but I know that
yeah.
it happens. I want to talk more about when you encountered, especially the first time around,
yeah.
when you encountered those guys who, this is not debatable, because there are a lot of guys that they're still living in denial. They're going, well, I may have some tendencies, but I'm not a bad guy.
Right.
All right, you're already in jail, dude.
Right.
That discussion is over.
Yeah.
We pretty much met the facts. The evidence is clear. Now, what? So I'd like to get some feedback on what that first experience was like, both for you, for reconciling with your own past,
yeah.
and what kind of reaction did you get from those guys?
Absolutely.
We'll be right back with Marty Martin after these messages. Everybody holding up all right in there? They're all quiet.
No, they weren't.
party's got their attention. All right. Any comments on Facebook we need to deal with?
Someone said hi.
No. Yeah.
Hi. Who was it?
Anna Rodriguez.
Oh yeah.
Or Anna.
Anna. Yeah. She's a promotions expert. She does events for Gateway. And
I know Anna.
Ministries. Yeah.
Yeah, working on the thing with Jennifer Strickland and.
Yeah.
Anna's
she did one for Carrie Oles.
Yeah.
And for Jennifer.
Yep.
When Jennifer launched her book. Hi, Anna. Okay. Timer.
Done.
Call Frank Day. He really wants to talk to you. He really does. 214-699-9650. I want to see his phone ring while he's sitting over there off screen if he's not busy texting. All right. Hey, welcome back to Meet the Messenger. We're in studio today with Marty Martin, who leads a ministry for men who have found themselves in jail as registered sex offenders and perpetrators of various sex crimes, sexual assault, and things of that nature. Now, Marty, before the break, we were talking about the fact that you have experienced this in your life, and one of the first comments you made to the panel that considered your invitation to the prisons, the first thing you said was, I'm not angry. But I know that there are a lot of people who kind of come and they look at a ministry like that as a therapeutic revenge. Mm-hmm. What was that first encounter like when they gathered these men in the room? I'm guessing that there was something in you that maybe saw in their faces the face of your abuser.
You know, that's what's so strange is it wasn't like that at all.
Wow.
When I looked across the room, I saw all kinds of different men. And I realized that at one point they were somebody's little boy.
Wow.
They were, you know, somebody's dad. They're somebody's brother. I saw them as real people, and that's really what that's what I had to see. I had to see them through the eyes of Jesus, and I'm so grateful that God gave me that because I was able to come into it with a much different angle. And I think one of the things you mentioned is what was the first class like?
Yeah.
And so that was my first impression. There was a 63-year-old man who had been in there for 30 years.
Wow.
And he's on the first row. And I get these guys 9 months before their release. So he's about to get out. There's not much lifetime left. He's not going to be able to reinvent himself at this point. He's going out basically to just see
Retire.
If there's anything he
yeah.
can do. And he told me, he said, you know, I've been in prison for 30 years. And he said, I've never met a bad person. I've met a lot of good people that have made some terrible mistakes.
Wow.
And I realized that. And just don't get me wrong, though, when I say these compassionate things that I don't realize what they've done. I do. And
yeah.
I keep that on the forefront at all times. But that was something that I believe God had him tell me. Because I needed to hear that because I never forgot that. And he said, when I get out, he said, all I want to do is just grow fruits and vegetables and give it to food banks. And that's all he wanted to do. So that was the first guy that I ever met. And so they're funneling in. We take 50 at a time. We keep it small on purpose because I want it to be somewhat interactive. And there was a couple of guys that walked in and they'd actually tattooed the whites of their eyes bright red. So you're looking at him, you're thinking, okay, the Bible needs to be really big today because if words can fix this, they need to fix this right now.
Wow.
But interesting, you know, because, you know, you have to get past that look, that hard look, that hard feel, and work to that place. And, you know, we have a stack of surveys that are just phenomenal. They're over the top. They're guys saying, I've never heard anyone tell me the things that she's telling us. Can we get more of her? And so once that program got started, and now we're 2.5, almost 3 years in, I received the governor's award for that program.
Wow.
And and so now they're like talking about giving me my own dorm. I said, with the pedophiles and the rapists and everyone?
Yay!
I know, it looks really weird. It's really strange, but I'm like, how can I be excited about this? And here's how. Because if I can stop them from perpetrating, if I can stop them from getting a hold of another victim, then I've won already.
Well, and one step beyond that, and I know you've thought about this, but I want to make sure that it comes out in the audience as well. The idea that birds of a feather flock together also says that if a person has had the experience of being a pedophile, being a sexual molester, that they probably have hung with people who do.
They do.
And when you can transform one, you have created a center of influence to go back into a place that no one else would want to go. To walk back into that circle of friends and go, look, I used to hang with you. But just like so many people come out of prisons, rehabilitated from drugs or rehabilitated from physical assaults or whatever it is, these guys still have a circle of influence in the friends they hung out with before they got there.
Right.
And while they may not go back and say, hey, I want to repeat this lifestyle, they may very well have the influence to speak into those people and go, there's a reason that I'm free now.
Yeah. Well, they usually don't speak. I mean, this is such a secretive thing. This is something that stews on the inside of people that they declare they will never talk about. Of course, once they get caught, then it's hard for them to talk.
It kind of changes that game.
Then getting them to talk and start being open about some of the struggles that they have on the inside. Because what we're finding is as we start digging around in these guys' hearts and lives and get them to open up and talk a little bit, what we're discovering is that many of them have been molested. Many of them have been raped, and this has been repeating itself in their lives, and they're just afraid to talk about it. It's a very difficult thing for a man to talk about things like that.
I was molested at 9 years old as well, and the journey that led me down, 25 years addicted to pornography, the first 10 years of my life, my wife went through hell, you know, coping with all of the issues that I was dealing with. But it was her ability to stand strong and fight for our marriage
Absolutely.
That allowed me to find the grace. And I think there are a lot of people who are still struggling with those ideas. Their identity is crushed in it. Their strength is crushed in it. Their willingness to fight is crushed in it. And like you said, it's not something you have a conversation with at Starbucks. Hey, let's talk about it. It just doesn't happen like that. And so how do you as a previous victim, and I use that word intentionally, I want to know what your feeling is on that. Like you said, it's a long process to no longer be a victim. My wife was a victim of rape before we were married. And one of the things that I see a lot of people challenge with is how do you stop declaring I am a victim and start living in the freedom that was an event and that time has passed? And I know that's a challenge, but is that part of what you have the conversation with these men in prison? When we come back from the break, I want to kind of talk about how you use that post-victim mentality in ministering to them as well, especially for those that, as you say, the statistics show many of them have been led by their own experiences to perpetrate the crimes they do.
Yeah.
We'll be right back after this. Okay, you chatterboxes over there, I can hear every word you're saying, and you're bouncing around is very distracting. If you're going to do that, do it in there. I need you to stay here, but I need you to pay attention to what we're doing and not distract me. You're like that little ball on the karaoke thing that bounces over the words.
Energizer Bunny.
He told me I look like an angry Bugs Bunny.
An angry Bugs Bunny?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
He was stomping.
The eyebrows. All right. So we're good on time so far, right?
Uh-huh.
So this 8 minutes is spot on. Good.
And this is 4.
Yeah, but we need 8.
Okay.
Because we've done 8 and 8. So this is our final 8. That'll take us to 24, and then we'll go to 4 for the final.
Okay.
So we haven't gone over yet. We're good. All right. Welcome back to Meet the Messenger. When you talk about the victim mentality, would you say that you live this arena of your life as a post-victim mentality?
Absolutely. I had no idea I had a choice. You know, I mean, I had never been to therapy. I had never even seen a counselor. And what I did is I read my Bible from cover to cover. I had struggles in believing some of it. But when I said, God, you know, I accepted you as Christ, but where's the joy thing? I remember walking around and saying, where's the joy thing? I don't have the joy thing. What are all these people happy about? You know, I couldn't understand. And I began to really seek the Lord. And he just started revealing to me, of course, you know, I'd gone through some struggles, just as you were saying earlier, that you and Karen had your struggles. Well, I had my own struggles in my marriage. And my husband set me down 3 months into our marriage and says, "I don't think this is gonna work." And I'm like, "It's been 3 months. What are
you
kidding
me? Didn't
give
that much of a try, did you?"
Yeah, right. And so anyway, he said, "Look, I'm gonna be kind to you and tell you that whatever's wrong with you, it has something to do with your past." And that hurt. It hurt so bad because I thought, you know, my past is something I can't do anything about.
Yeah, I can't fix that.
I can't fix that.
Right.
And so I thought, you know, that is just really not a very nice thing to say to me.
And it's not fair to judge me based on what happened to me.
Yeah. And so that's my thoughts. And when I started reading my Bible and really getting into the Word and saying, "Lord, do you fix people?" And God began to lay out a plan. And he said, "Here's what I want you to do." He said, "I want you to drive to every location you can remember being hurt, and I'll meet you there." And he said, "Everywhere you've cried, you're going to dance."
Wow.
And I was like, "Oh, okay." So I took off and with my little notepad, and I drove to some of these locations. I didn't need a stinking notepad. All I did was cry, you know. And I would get out, and I'd look at those old houses, and I would remember the horrible things that happened to me. And I would say, "God, this is not working. This is a horrible idea. Who goes back to revisit their past?" And I'd go home and I'd buy those little 39-cent on sale notebooks, and I'd begin to write about everything that happened to me. And that became my first book, The Father Wants to Heal His Little Girls. And
wow.
This was the book that I used to kind of help process people through their past.
But this is your process.
That was my process. So this is the victim process, and this is how I would work with victims. And so I would tell the victims, you know, you are going to have to learn to let go and to forgive and to accept. You know, it doesn't seem like we need to accept what someone else has done to us. But, you know, to be real honest, we're left with that mess.
Yeah.
When someone hurts us, we are left with that mess. We have to reconcile that, and we have to lay it down. And we say, "I am not going to let this define me. I am going to look to God, and I am going to allow him to heal my heart." And that's really where, you know, I found my life began to change.
You see the pranksters all the time, and I know this is a strange analogy, but I think it fits very well. You see the pranksters on usually older movies where they take a paper bag and they fill it full of dog mess.
Mm-hmm.
And then they light it on fire and leave it on someone's doorstep.
Nice, Lauren. Where's this going?
In my experience, that's what it's like to be the victim.
Oh, it is. You are absolutely right.
Because you've got this pile of burning dog mess on your front door.
And you're left with it.
And nobody's coming to clean that up.
Nobody's coming to clean it up.
And it's on fire.
It's you.
And your options are find a way to put the fire out or just tolerate what it leaves behind.
Yeah.
And being a victim is very much like that.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, many people just let it burn out and lay there.
Yeah.
And you see the evidence of that in their life.
Yeah.
You're like, okay, so you've never really dealt with that, have you?
Well, it's like people that's been going to therapy for years.
Yes.
Oh, I'm seeing
my
therapist today.
Time.
It's been 5 years. You see the same therapist every week. I'm not making fun of that.
Some people process
differently.
But
all they can do, I'm just being real with you, all they can do is make you understand.
Well,
what
happens
but
as a result is
take it away.
You walk to the front door and you open the door and you go, "See?
See?
That's what they left
See?
Here." And then they close the door. And the next person that comes, they're
like,
"See? That's what they
nice.
Left here." And every conversation.
I'll meet you next week, same place, same time. And you
come
can see
it.
Again.
Yes, yeah.
And I'm just
and every
I'm
guest
talking
that visits
about
and
we have
comes
got,
in.
And that's what Bold Walk was birthed from. We've got to learn to move beyond the things that have happened in our lives. We have got to learn to take what has
okay,
happened.
Okay, so here's a stranger analogy
okay.
for you.
Oh, here we go.
Jesus looked forward to the cross with joy.
Pain.
Because
mm-hmm.
of what lie on the other side.
Yeah.
And we've got to look at that pile of burning dog mess on the front porch and go, "What's on the other side of it?" I love the way, I believe it was Bob Hamp the first time, was expressing dealing with issues. And he said, you know, we often go, "Wow, look at the size of that problem. Look at that right there. And look what it did in the sun. Look how it affected this part of my life. And then over here. And he said, we've got to stop looking at the problem, that pile of burning dog mess on the front porch. Stop looking behind it and go, "There's God."
But it's hard to do it without trust. You have to trust
yeah.
in Jesus. And that's what I see all this therapy and even with the sex offenders that I work with, all those therapists, they all sit through my program every time I go. And they all sit through it and they're just like, wow, you really give good information. And it's like, but there's one thing that I give that nobody else gives, and that's Jesus. That's Jesus. Jesus changes hearts. He changes lives. And we just don't believe that he can really take a heart and completely transform it when it belongs to him.
What we're really asking to do is just trade slave masters.
Yeah.
You've been a slave
yeah.
to sin. Be a slave to righteousness.
Be a slave.
We're going to unplug
yeah.
this one and plug in that one.
Well, you've got to trade in a lot of stuff. There's a lot
yeah.
of trade-off that goes with that. You've got to lay down your sin. You got to lay down so many things. You got to lay down your shame. You have to lay down your victimization. And you have to take on hope. Oh, wow, we don't want hope, do we?
One of the things that I remember talking with a lady, and her area of expertise was domestic violence. And she had a television interview, and I was just coaching her through the interview. And it was one of those 5 minutes on a program similar to The View. And she knew they were going to be hostile. And it was during Domestic Violence Month. And so she's like, I know they're going to just hit me with, how can you move past this? And the first lady, first one out of the box, said, what do you mean by no longer being a victim? And they were just ready to rip her up. She said, it's a choice to live as a victim or to live as though this is the past
yeah.
and hope has come. And the interviewers just went, they were just stunned.
Yeah.
They're like, hope. But you've been beaten.
Yeah.
Yes. But you've had your freedom taken away.
Yeah.
Yes. But somebody abused you.
Yeah.
Yes. And you have hope? Yes. It's called the cross.
Yeah.
And on the other side of this is eternity
yeah.
in heaven. And I wasn't made for this place in the first place.
You know, I remember asking God, I said, Lord, why did you let all these things happen to me? I mean, I used to ask it every day. Why? Always wanted the why question answered. And finally, one day, I thought, it's pretty silly that I just keep asking God why. And so finally, one day, I said, look, God, I'm going to make a deal with you. I'm done with why. Here's the deal. If I'm not ready to walk away from my relationship with you as a result of not getting my question why answered, then why am I holding it against you?
And what kind of God are you
yeah,
if you can't answer that question?
Yeah. Well, I wanted my whys answered. And I finally said, I'm done with why. I don't care. I just want to move forward. I want to move forward in joy and hope. And so I don't need the whys answered anymore. And it was like the heavens opened up.
It was like somebody cut the bungee cord.
Oh, my goodness. Freedom. Freedom.
Mm-hmm. So when we come back from the break, I want to talk about how people can engage you. Obviously, we'll talk about the books, but I know you're available for speaking engagements beyond the prison.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll talk about that when we come back from the break. Once again, thank you for watching Meet the Messenger, and we'll talk for just a few minutes more with Marty Martin right after this.
Robin.
Hello, Robin. How are you?
Yeah, how are
you? He didn't tell you what he was bringing you into, did he? Yeah, welcome. I would come up and shake your hand, but I'm wired to a microphone, so it's a little hard for me to move from here. No, she's okay now. But you are on camera, so come on over and say hi. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
You're a little red.
Hi. Yeah, I'm hot right now.
Oh, okay.
Jesse didn't have AC. You gotta remember that.
Yeah.
That I understand.
All right. Set that for
4 minutes.
Two.
Oh, 2 minutes.
Yeah, because we went a little bit over. So we're just going to wrap up and close. Do you not know how to change the time?
Yeah.
Or are you just creating a different clock? Okay.
You have to create a different clock. You should type in the time and change it for you. I'm going to change the color.
Ready? Yep. In our final segment on Meet the Messenger today with Marty Martin, I just want to give you a chance, as we always do. We've taught, we've demonstrated, now to activate you. You may be a victim of sexual assault or sexual abuse in your life. You may be a perpetrator who has managed to keep the secret up to this point. And I'm going to challenge you. I know that sexual addiction can stay a resident in your life even as a believer, because I lived it. I know that you can harbor all those ideas and thoughts in your mind and have those expectations of your spouse, have those expectations of a date, and not live a life that God empowered you to live. And if that's your challenge, send an email. You can send it to me at lauren@transforminggrace.tv. You can send it to Marty. What's the best way to reach you?
MartyMartinMinistries.org.
MartyMartinMinistries.org. Now, tell us a little bit about the book. Who are the readers of these two books, and where can they get them?
This one is going to be mainly if you're still going through your process, if you need to be healed, if you're a woman who has suffered and you're trying to figure out what your problem is, this is going to help you do that.
Is it work for men too?
You know, it helps husbands understand what wives
go
through. This one, Bold Walk, is about overcoming obstacles. It's about understanding the spiritual process and how God takes us through different things in order to get us to a place where he can use us.
Okay.
So this just helps you move beyond those boundaries that you may have placed on yourself.
Now, for people who might want you to come and speak to their crowd,
mm-hmm.
do you do small groups and life groups and things of that nature, or do you speak more to churches and prisons?
Churches, prisons, women's events, things like that. And I have done some small groups. Mm-hmm.
Probably a little harder with your calendar.
Yeah, but we get it all in.
And the best way to reach you is through the website?
Yes.
MartyMartinMinistries.org.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. Well, I very much appreciate you
Thank
being
you.
Here.
Good to
I'm
see
honored
you.
By your presence, and I bless you for what you're doing, what God's called you to do, and I know he will continue to honor your faithful service. Thank you again for watching Meet the Messenger. I hope you've enjoyed our time with Marty Martin. You can reach out to her at MartyMartinMinistries.org, and if you know someone who's struggling with being a victim of sexual assault, help them find the way to healing through God, the Father, wants to heal his little girls, letting go of the scars, and Bold Walk. When you're ready to live a post-victim life, there is an opportunity, and it really is what God has designed for you, to live in victory and not in the past. I am J. Lauren Norris. You've been watching Meet the Messenger TV. Have a blessed day. That's a wrap on that one.
Okie doke.
Wardrobe
Thank
change. You are you up next, Jeff?
I didn't drink the water. It's still good.